In this video, we are going to talk about the physical structure of the diode. And let me say upfront that this video and the next video may be not nice for those who do not like physics. So please bear with me and I'll try to give you a flavor of what's happening here. Don't get scared of the equations that you will see. You will not have to memorize any of the equations that you will see. What you need to do here is to understand only the concept of what's happening, what's going on. So let's start with the semiconductor, the silicon crystal. The silicon atoms, they have four valence electrons, four electrons in the last orbit. And thus, when the silicon crystal forms, each atom, each silicon atom, it combines or it forms bonds with four other silicon atoms, so that it has eight electrons in the last orbit. As we know from the chemistry, the atoms, they tend to have eight electrons in the last orbit. So since each one it has four electrons, so it will combine with four other silicon atoms inside the crystal, so that it will share one electron with each atom and takes one electron from the other atom. So here there will be two electrons, one from this atom and the other electron from this atom, and the same thing for the four bonds, okay? So that now we have eight electrons. So this is what we call intrinsic silicon. Intrinsic means pure silicon, so all the atoms are silicon. What happens is sometimes we dope the silicon crystal with some other atoms. So we inject some other atoms in the silicon crystal. For example, we can inject the phosphorus atom inside the silicon crystal. And the phosphorus atom, it has five electrons in the last orbit. So if we inject now the phosphorus atom inside the silicon crystal and it has five electrons, it will use four of them to connect with four other silicon atoms, while the fifth electron will be free to move inside the silicon crystal. So now we have an extra electron, a free electron moving in the silicon crystal for each phosphorus atom. For each phosphorus atom, there will be an extra electron moving around the silicon crystal, free to move. It can form current later. This is what we call n-doped silicon. N comes from the electrons or the negative, okay? N-doped silicon, because this kind of doping, it provides an extra electron, it provides a negative charge in the crystal. Of course, when the phosphorus atom loses one electron, the atom itself will have a positive charge. That's why we call it the positive ion. What's the difference between the ion and the electron? The electron can move around, while the ion, ionized atom, it means an atom that lost an electron. The atom cannot move, right? So the phosphorus atom will be ionized, positively ionized. It will represent a positive ion that cannot move, while the electron here, this is the electron lost from the phosphorus atom, it will be moving around the silicon crystal. This is what we call n-doped silicon. On the other hand, if we dope the silicon crystal with an atom that has three electrons in the last orbit, like the boron atom, in this case, the boron atom is going to connect with three silicon atoms with the three electrons in the last orbit, while in the last bond, in the fourth silicon atom, there will be only one electron coming from the silicon atom, and there will be an empty place that was supposed to be filled with an electron from the boron atom, but unfortunately, the boron atom doesn't have enough electrons to fill this place. That's why this place, we call it, that was supposed to be filled with an electron, we call it a hole. We call it a hole. So if a boron atom connects with three silicon atoms, here the fourth bond, it will contain one electron here and one hole, okay? And this hole, we deal with it as a positive charge. Why do we deal with it as a positive charge? Because it is possible that in the crystal, due to thermal effect, it is possible that another bond is going to break.
another bond in the crystal is going to break due to thermal effect. When the other bond breaks, then the electron, one of the electrons that was supposed to be in this bond, is going to go and fill this hole. And when the electron here goes and fills this hole, in place of that electron, there will be a hole. So effectively, the hole moved from here to here. When the electron went from this bond to fill the hole here, the hole effectively moved from this place to this place. That's why we deal with the hole as something opposite to the electron. So if the electron moves from in this direction, the hole moves to the opposite direction. That's why we deal with the hole as a positive charge. So here, the hole, we deal with it as a positive charge. Also, when the electron moves to fill the hole, the boron atom now is considered to be a negative ion. So if the boron atom receives an electron, if it receives an electron, it will be considered as a negative ion. And now, as you see, the hole can move through the crystal, very similar to the movement of the electrons. However, the holes, in order to move, another bond has to be broken, and an electron comes from the other bond to fill the hole. In this case, the hole will move. So now we have two types of charges, free electrons and free holes. The holes, they are considered as positive charges, and they are going to move throughout the crystal in the p-doped silicon. And that's why we call it p-doped silicon, because we dope the silicon so that we have a lot of p's, a lot of positive charges, which are the holes. While in the n-doped silicon, we have a lot of electrons when we dope the silicon with phosphorus atoms, for example, with 5 electrons in the last orbit. There will be extra electrons moving through the crystal. That's why we call it n-doped silicon. N comes from the negative. While here this is p-doped silicon, p comes from the positive charge, which are the holes. Let's first talk about the intrinsic silicon. Intrinsic means pure silicon, pure silicon. Okay? In the pure silicon, if we put it under low temperature, relatively low temperature, all the bonds will be intact. No bond, or there are no broken bonds at all. All the bonds are there. There are no free charges in the silicon crystal, right? So if we have a silicon crystal under relatively low temperature, all the bonds will be intact. Intact means they are not broken and there are no free electrons. However, if you raise the temperature relatively, like even any temperature above 0 Kelvin, okay, some bonds will gain enough energy to break. Some bonds will gain enough energy to break. So let's now talk about silicon atoms. All of them are silicon. So under low temperature, all the bonds are there. If you raise the temperature a little bit, if you raise the temperature a little bit, even in room temperature, even for any temperature greater than 0 Kelvin, some bonds will start to break. Break means an electron will go to be free and it will leave a hole behind. So an electron will go free and it will leave a hole behind. Here, this bond also will break. For example, there will be an electron that will go free and it will leave a hole behind. This process, we call it thermal ionization. It's an ionization, it's a kind of breaking the bonds due to the thermal effect, due to even the room temperature. You don't need to heat it or something. It's in the regular temperature, anything about 0 Kelvin, okay? You can find that some bonds are going to break. There will be electrons and holes. So under normal situation, some bonds are broken and there are electrons, there are holes. At the same time, some electrons, they go back and combine with holes. Some electrons, they go back and combine with the holes. And in this case, the electron, the hole, will disappear. There will be no free electron and there will be no hole, right? So the electron goes back to the bond, and this is called recombination. So we have for intrinsic silicon, for pure silicon, we have two processes. The first process is thermal ionization, where the bonds break. And for each bond that breaks, there will be an electron, free electron, and free hole. The other process is recombination, where an electron goes back and recombines with a hole. These two processes are opposite to each other, right? The thermal ionization, it gives you an electron and hole. The recombination, it takes an electron and hole and it combines them together. Under thermal equilibrium, the generation rate, the thermal ionization rate, is equal to the recombination rate. So the rate of breaking the bonds will be equal to the rate of recombining. So under thermal equilibrium, the generation rate, the rate of breaking the bonds due to thermal effect, will be equal to the recombination rate. And we'll find that in the intrinsic silicon, the concentration of the electrons will be equal to the concentration of the holes, equals to something we call N intrinsic. This is the concentration of the intrinsic silicon. Why the concentration of the electrons equals to the concentration of holes under thermal equilibrium? Because for each bond that breaks, it will give you one hole and one electron, right? So the number of electrons here will be equal to the number of holes. That's why we say the concentration of electrons equals the concentration of holes equals, that's something we call it intrinsic concentration. The concentration is measured how many carriers per centimeter cubed. We call it, instead of charge, we call it carrier, because it carries the current, it carries the charge from one place to another place. So the intrinsic concentration for the silicon is 1.5 10 to the power 10 carriers per centimeter cube at 300 Kelvin. Okay? I would ask you, is that a large concentration? This is a large concentration, it's 10 to the power 10. You would say yes, this is 10 to the power 10, 1.5, 10 to the power 10. This is a very huge concentration per centimeter cube. But I tell you, wait, compare it to the concentration of the silicon atoms. The silicon atoms themselves, their concentration in the crystal is 5, 10 to the power 22 atoms per centimeter cube. So that here, the concentration of electrons and holes is very, very small compared to the concentration of the silicon atoms in the pure silicon crystal. Okay, so this is for the with respect to the intrinsic silicon. In the intrinsic silicon, the carriers or the charges, the free charges, they come from the thermal effect, from breaking the bonds due to thermal effect. You will get for each bond that is broken, one electron, one hole. And then there is the opposite process, which is recombination. Okay, and in the recombination, the electron goes back to fill a hole. Under thermal equilibrium, the generation rate equals recombination rate, and the concentration of the electrons equals the concentration of holes. Okay, and always we have an equation that always apply with us, whether we have an intrinsic silicon or we have a doped, n-doped or p-doped, is that the multiplication of the concentration of n times the concentration of p must be ni squared, equals to the intrinsic concentration squared, which means that even for the crystals that we are going to study later, if the concentration of N increases, the concentration of P must decrease, so that this is always satisfied. Ni is fixed. Ni, the intrinsic concentration, this is a fixed number. So if you increase the concentration of N of electrons, the concentration of holes must decrease. Let's now move to the n-doped silicon. When you add phosphorus atom, if you add a phosphorus atom to the silicon, for each phosphorus atom that you add, you will get one free electron, right? Because the phosphorus atom has five electrons, five
electrons in the last orbit, it will combine with four of them, with four silicon atoms, and the fifth electron will be free to move. So for each phosphorus atom, there will be one free electron to move, which means that approximately the concentration of electrons in an n-doped silicon, we write it like this, concentration of electrons in an n-doped silicon approximately will be equal to the concentration of the phosphorus atom. Concentration of, we call it, by the way, donor atom. It doesn't need necessarily to be phosphorus. It's any atom with five electrons, we call it donor atom. Why donor? Because it donates one of the electrons to the crystal. We call it the donor atom. Okay? So the concentration of the phosphorus or the donor atoms approximately will be equal to the concentration of the electrons. As we said, we have this relation that the concentration of N times the concentration of P, the N in the N-doped silicon, times the concentration of P in the N-doped silicon, must be equal to the intrinsic concentration squared, which is constant. Here, when we add donor atoms, a lot of donor atoms, high concentration of donor atoms, I'll give you an example now, the concentration of the electrons will increase, which means that by default, the concentration of holes is going to decrease, okay? And let's see this example here. If we have a silicon crystal at 300 Kelvin, okay, the donor atom concentration, the concentration of the phosphorus atoms, will be 10 to the power 17 atoms per centimeter cubed. In this case, the concentration of the electrons will be approximately the same as the concentration of the donor atoms. Why do we say approximately, by the way? Why do we say approximately? Because the electrons, they come from the phosphorus atoms, and they come also from the thermal ionization process, right? But usually the amount of the donor atoms, the concentration of the donor atoms, look, it's 10 to the power 17, it's much higher than the thermal process. The thermal process gives you in the range of 10 to the power 10, as in the intrinsic silicon. Right, but here we add donor atoms in the range of 10 to the power 17 per centimeter cube. So usually we neglect here the thermal effect, and we say that the concentration of the electrons in an N-doped silicon will be approximately the same as the concentration of the donor atoms. In this case, the concentration of the holes, in an N-doped silicon will be Ni squared divided by N naught, and you will get that the concentration of the holes will be small. It's in the range of 10 to the power 3. So here in the N-doped silicon, and this is the information that we want to get, in an N-doped silicon, you will have a huge amount of electrons, which we say that the electrons will represent majority carriers, while the number of holes will be, or the amount of holes will be very small compared to the electrons. That's why we call the holes minority carriers. So here the electrons are called majority carriers, and the holes are called minority. Why is that? Because the amount of electrons here is very high. It's huge compared to the amount of holes. So this is majority carriers, this is minority carriers. On the other hand, if we talk about P-doped silicon, where we inject the silicon crystal with boron atoms, with atoms that contain three electrons in the last orbit, then for each boron atom that we add, we will get one hole. And hence we say that the concentration of the holes in a P-doped silicon is approximately equal to the concentration of the acceptor atoms. And the concentration of the acceptor atoms here, the acceptor atoms are the same as the boron atoms. Why do we call them acceptor atoms? Because the boron atoms, they contain only three electrons, and there is a hole in the fourth connection, right? So the boron atoms here, they are willing to accept an electron. That's why we call the boron atoms, we call them the acceptor atoms. The phosphorus atoms in the N-doped silicon,
The phosphorus atoms, they used to donate an electron. That's why we call them donor atoms. But here, the boron atoms, they have a hole. They are willing to accept an electron to fill this hole. That's why we call them the acceptor atoms. So the acceptor atoms is the same as the boron atoms. So the concentration of holes will be approximately equal to the concentration of the acceptor atoms. Why do we say approximately? Because the holes, they do not result only from the acceptor atoms, from the boron atoms, they also result from the thermal ionization. Due to thermal ionization, when a bond breaks, it will give you one hole and one electron, right? So the holes result from two things, thermal ionization and from the injected acceptor atoms or boron atoms. However, the concentration of the acceptor atoms or boron atoms, usually it's much, much bigger than the concentration of holes that result from the thermal ionization. That's why we say that the concentration of holes is much, is approximately the same as the concentration of the boron atoms or acceptor atoms, and ignoring the concentration of holes that results from the thermal ionization. And here also we have the same relation that says that the concentration of electrons times the concentration of holes in any crystal must be equal to the intrinsic concentration squared, which is constant. The intrinsic concentration squared is constant, which means that if you increase the concentration of holes, the concentration of electrons is going to decrease, okay? From this relation, we can calculate the concentration of electrons in a p-doped silicon. It will be the intrinsic concentration squared divided by the concentration of holes, which is the same as the concentration of the acceptor atoms. For example, if we dope a silicon crystal with some boron atoms, acceptor atoms of concentration 10 to the power 18, you'll find that the concentration of holes approximately will be the same as the concentration of the boron atoms, 10 to the power 18. Using this relation, we can calculate the concentration of electrons, which is the intrinsic concentration squared divided by the concentration of holes. You'll find that the concentration of electrons will be in the range of 10 to the power 2. As you see, huge difference between the concentration of holes and the concentration of electrons. That's why we call the holes here, we call it the majority carriers. In a p-doped silicon, we call the holes majority carriers because they represent a huge concentration compared to the electrons. While the electrons, they are called here minority carriers. In the n-doped silicon, previous slide, the electrons were the majority carriers, while the holes were the minority carriers. Here we have the opposite. In the p-doped silicon, the holes are the majority carriers, while the electrons are the minority carriers. So this is with respect to intrinsic silicon, n-doped silicon, p-doped silicon. Before we end this video, I'm going to talk about two mechanisms for currents in the semiconductors. Okay, the first current is called the diffusion current. Diffusion means what? Means that if you bring any device with high concentration of electrons here, let's say, and low concentration of electrons here, what do you expect to happen? If you bring a device with high concentration, this is distance x, let's say, okay, this is the concentration of electrons, and what happens if you have high concentration here, low concentration here? What do you expect to do, or what do you expect that the electrons will do? Of course, the electrons are going to move from the high concentration towards the low concentration. This is normal, this is by nature. If you have high pressure of water here, and you connect it to a low pressure of water, high volume of water, you connect it to an empty jar or something, the water will flow from the high pressure to the low pressure. Same for the electrons. The electrons will flow from the high density to the low density. This is what we call diffusion current. We say that the electrons are going to diffuse from the high to the low. The diffusion current, okay, it depends on the charge, depends on something called the diffusion constant, and depends on the slope of the density or the concentration of the electrons. As the concentration of the electrons becomes more steep,
then the current is going to be higher. Same for the holes. If the concentration of the holes is more steep, the change in the concentration, this is the differentiation of the concentration, dp by dx. As the dp by dx, the change in the concentration is high, okay, then the current will be higher. We notice here that there is a negative sign. Why there is a negative sign? Because if dn by dx, let's put it like this. We are talking about the positive current. Positive current means the current going in the direction of x. This is the current, okay? By the way, this is the current density, and current per unit area, J. But let's talk about the current. If the concentration of the electrons, if we talk about the electrons, if the concentration of the electrons dN by dx is positive. If dN by dx is positive, this means that the concentration is increasing here with x, right? If dN by dx, so this case dN by dx is positive. The concentration is increasing. What happens? The current, the electrons are going to move in this direction. And if the electrons move in this direction, the positive current will be in this direction. So it will be positive. The positive current will be in the regular direction of x. But for the holes, if the same thing, dp by dx is positive, dp by dx is positive, this means that the concentration of the p increases with x. The concentration of p increases with x. What happens, Shabab? Dp by dx is positive, this means that p is increasing with x, right? The p is going to move in this direction. The positive charges are going to move in this direction, which means that the current in this direction will be negative, right? The current in this direction will be negative. If the positive charges are moving in this direction, this means that the current in this direction is negative. That's why we have a negative sign here. If dp by dx is positive, the current of the holes will be positive. If dN by dx is positive, the current will be positive, okay? Here the current will be negative, here the current will be positive, as we explained here. Because here, if the electrons moves in this direction, the positive current will be in this direction. Here, if the holes move in this direction, the current in this direction will be negative. We'll stop here in this video, and there is another current called the drift current. So this is called the diffusion current due to the difference in concentration. The drift current, it's the regular current that we studied before in the circuit analysis. If you apply an electric field on a charge, then that will cause a current. This charge is going to move, and it is given by this equation. It depends on the electric field, it depends on the charge, it depends on the concentration of charges, and the mobility. Something called the mobility is the ability for the charge to move. Mu n, that is the mobility of the electrons. For the holes, again, it depends on the charge of the electron, because the hole is effectively an electron moving, okay? It depends on the concentration of holes, the electric field, and the mobility of holes. Somebody may ask, why do we have mobility for electrons and mobility for holes? They found that they are different. Although the hole effectively moves by an electron coming and filling them, okay, but the ability for an electron to move freely in the crystal is higher than, mu n is higher than the ability for a hole to move from one bond to another bond. Because in order for the hole to move, there should be an electron to fill the hole. And this electron will come from another bond, right? So the mobility of the holes, we found it to be less than the mobility of the electrons. So this is called the drift current due to an electric field affecting charges. This is the diffusion current even without an electric field. If there is a difference in the concentration between the charges, there will be a current by nature from the high concentration to the low concentration. So these are two types of currents that happen in the semiconductor. We'll stop here in this video and we'll continue in the next video, inshallah.